And I'm really impressed with the scientific research that's coming out on showing that psychedelics in combination with spiritual practices show the greatest effects, like meditation, but also prayer. There's some new studies, large scale studies, that show that the combination is better than either alone. And so the more you can integrate those psychedelic experiences into the rest of your life, the more productive it'll be. But, what's interesting to me though is that there's lots of different routes to this certain transcendent state of being. There's lots of different routes. I'm wondering, is psychedelics, is that, do you think there's nothing else, practices that can take us to that same, to those same insights? What are your thoughts on that?
It depends which insights and experiences you're talking about. I mean, it's a Venn diagram for me, which in certain cases barely overlaps between what is, the real purpose of meditation or the kinds of experiences people can have in meditation and really the essence of it, I mean, the real utility of it, and the kinds of experiences people can have on psychedelics. The way I distinguish them is that there's consciousness and its contents. And almost any attempt, successful or otherwise, to change experience is a matter of changing the contents of consciousness. That is really the goal. And, whether it's thought about in those terms or not, and that is the effect. And, by definition, all of these changes are temporary. So you can have a peak experience through taking psychedelics, you can have a peak experience through, going on a meditation retreat and meditating for 14 hours a day for a month. And these kinds of experiences can be pretty similar. The difference with psychedelics is you're guaranteed to have a radical change in the contents of your consciousness, and it's guaranteed to happen more or less within the hour, right? So it's like if someone gives you an effective dose of LSD or psilocybin, there's no question something's going to happen right now. It may be a terrifying something, but if nothing else, it will prove to you that experience is a highly plastic thing and it is possible to inhabit states of consciousness that you never dreamed were possible a mere hour ago. And again, you can get there with meditation and you can get there in a much more orderly way without the downside. I mean, some people can go crazy on a meditation retreat as well. So, it's not that there's no risk, but it's not the same kind of spin of the roulette wheel where you're really not sure what you're going to get until you get it, all your attempts to control set and setting notwithstanding. So it is more orderly and it can go into very rarefied terrain. But the actual sweet spot for meditation, which is to say the transcendence that actually matters, is something that you can recognize about the nature of consciousness in any moment that's coincident with any contents. You don't actually need the pyrotechnics of the psychedelic experience or even the pyrotechnics of changes in state born of intense concentration and meditation to recognize this thing about the nature of consciousness. And, this thing is referred to by many names, but it's cutting through the illusion of the self or recognizing emptiness or non-duality. I mean, there are many sort of facets by which you could talk about it, but it's the loss of this sense of subject-object perception. It's the, and this is completely coincident with ordinary perception. I mean, you can drive a car in this state of consciousness. This is a perfectly functional state because it's not actually a state. I mean, this is the way consciousness is when you're no longer constructing this sense of being the center of consciousness. To speak of it in representational terms, it's like you can represent the world without representing a subject in your head, in your body, in the world. Most people have this additional sense that there's a homunculus in the head that's doing the thinking and the feeling and the reacting, and that can be taken offline. And how that relates to neurophysiology or what the default mode network is doing, I mean, that's an open question. But, based on the current literature, it seems like it's probably at least part of what the default mode network is doing, in addition to just producing mind wandering or daydreaming or just random thinking. There's a strain of thinking that is explicitly self-referential and and again, I don't know if this has actually been studied, but more than just self-referential thought, there's the difference between noticing thought as an appearance in consciousness among all the other appearances and being identified with thought, which is to say thinking without knowing that you're thinking. And that's the subtlest entanglement with thought, which does give this feeling of subject in the head, being the thinker. And so meditation can break that spell, and breaking that identification leaves everything else untouched. Now, it is in fact true that the more you do that, and the longer those moments of true non-duality or perception of emptiness last, then that does begin to change the character of the contents of consciousness as well, right? So that can begin to, you know, seem more rarefied and more psychedelic and more dreamlike. That's where some of that explicitly mystical language can come into even this sort of discussion, but it's never the point, and it's never the thing you're trying to maximize. And in fact, when you begin to practice in this non-dual way, it's explicitly part of the instruction that you need to break your attachment to any of those changes in consciousness that you think are a sign of something good happening. I mean, this is where the being mode versus the becoming mode, or the being mode versus the deficiency mode, you know, which isn't your terminology. That's where that emphasis as a matter of practice becomes the entire game, right? Which is, if being is really the point, if you've recognized something about the nature of consciousness that cannot be improved, it neither admits of being improved or suggests that there's any need to improve it, and it's compatible with anything else that can be noticed as the contents of consciousness. It's compatible with noticing physical pain or an ugly thought or anything that might arise. Well, then it's, at that point, it's not a matter of changing anything. It's a matter of continuing to notice this quality of consciousness, which is its centerlessness, its openness, its clarity, and then anything that changes, I mean, the feeling of, you know, joy or the feeling of bliss, I mean, anything that becomes, for most people, certainly in the beginning of meditation, a sign that meditation is actually working, all of that gets disavowed as an appearance in a dream that is meaningless. It has no meaning at that point. The fact that you suddenly feel good, that's not the point of meditation. And in that sense, most of what people experience with psychedelics, just the experience of being bowled over by incredibly intense and, you know, often very positive experience, right? Bliss and seeing colors of a sort, you know, colors in the natural world that you never imagined possible, and a feeling that the energy of your body is inseparable from the energy of the world, and, you know, the energetics of all of that, whatever the knob is in the brain that, you know, somewhere near the nucleus accumbens that you can grab and turn up to 11, well, then it got turned up to 12 there. And none of that is ultimately the point, right? None of that can be the point. And yet, it, again, it's the thing that if you've never experienced it, you know, you're someone who just can't imagine how different a human experience can be. And that lack of imagination becomes the reason why you are satisfied with Netflix and not hating your life. You get up each day and merely repeat that project. I don't know if that answered your question, but it gets somewhat paradoxical in terms of trying to equate what the project is from the point of view of meditation and the utility of psychedelics.
Yeah, it was really elucidating. I really appreciated that.